early rising in the morning. We ask you, God, that you would continue to bless us, keep us, and guide us on today. Ask that you would anoint these airways, God, as you have downloaded in them, let them download the information in us. Father, we give you thanks, we give you praise. Glory in Jesus. Amen. And with your blessing, good morning to you.
Good after morning, good after Super Bowl morning to you. and the team with the black quarterback won. Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to, Every Day We Rise. It's a great day to be alive, and welcome to the Seven Cities Forums of Hampton Roads presents Portsmouth Coffee Talks Morning Show. My name is James Lamoverton, and I'm here with co-hosts Leo Drake Stitt and Thomas the Colonel Chapman. Good morning, hosts.
Good morning, James.
Good morning.
How's everybody? Well, you know, we enjoyed the game. I think most of us were Kansas City leaning. Yeah. Am I correct?
And amazingly, it's the first Super Bowl I ever sat and watched the entire thing.
Mm-hmm. Just because it was historic.
Because it was a black quarterback that won.
On both sides. That's never happened. That's never happened. But anyway, we have a special guest with us this morning in the name of Vincent Epps. And I'm going to say this, you know, he's a graduate of Howard University and a colonel. He says the real HU. Pointing out Colonel is graduate of Norfolk State and Hampton University. So we had the same thing with Dr. Coletta Fairfax, you know, who is the real HU. So like I said, then we'll let y'all figure that out. Okay. Well, but anyway, many people thought Vincent was an NSU grad. And I was one of them, but he was a Howard grad, and he worked social work in the city of Virginia Beach. And it's an interesting story. I guess you'll touch in on that about how he got into dancing as a social worker in Virginia Beach and how that, you know, sort of kept him from counseling himself. But anyway, good morning, Vincent. How you doing?
Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning, Vinny.
I got a little anecdote to say. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for the invite. I never thought I would get on the show because I am not a graduate of IC Norcom High School.
but you did attend HBSH, you know, Historically right. Black High
there
School.
There was another school across the way.
There was another school?
Across the way. Crestwood High School.
Oh yeah. My goodness.
The Bombers, the Mighty Mighty Bombers.
Yes.
I told James that when we talked. I said, oh, wow, thanks for the invite. But I never thought I'd get on this show because you got to be a Graham. You know, and he reminded me that the Colonel went to Western Branch.
Okay, but listen, Vince, the Colonel
did graduate
Western Branch, but the Colonel is a member of the IC Norcom Alumni Association. Oh, okay. I want you to know that, okay?
Okay.
Hint. But anyway, I also want to mention that Vincent is a longtime member of Grove Baptist Church, Grove Church, which the Colonel and I are also members. And he's a longtime member of Kappa Alpha Psi Fraternity Incorporated, the Virginia Beach chapter, I believe.
Yes.
Okay. Well, anyway, as a matter of fact, they have a conclave. Was that what you call it, coming to the city of Portsmouth next month?
Yes, in March.
Our
provincial meeting is going to be held. It includes the District of Columbia, the State of Maryland, the Commonwealth of Virginia, and the island of Bermuda.
Oh, okay. Hey. Well, we welcome you and tell your brothers the casino is open.
They may not make the meeting if they go to the casino. Right. It seems that people go there at night and stay 24 right. hours.
Well, since we're in Black History Month, I wanted Vincent to come on and talk about his experience with, you know, a lot of people know about the Norfolk State Performing Arts Players. I don't know if that's the official title, but he was involved with that, even though he wasn't. Didn't attend Norfolk State. He was very involved there. And we talk a little bit about the history there, especially that period where Robert Wynn Jackson was there, which a lot of strides were made then. But Vincent, Talk about your early experience with Norfolk State and the players. You know, you, okay. you other places Good. Before you got there.
I better correct something before somebody gets me. I am. I also have a degree from NSU too, so I,
oh, okay.
I bleed green and gold. So
okay.
I don't want that to get misconstrued. I hold them very high.
Thanks for that correction.
And right now I'm adjunct professor in the Evelyn R. Strong School of Social Work. Mm-hmm. So I cannot let that slide by.
Okay.
I love them both.
And you hold them higher than that other
But then I hold them higher than that HI place. It's called HI, I believe. Is that what it is?
The last trip, I hold them very high. Thanks. And right now, I'm.
That's James, I think. Go ahead.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry yes. about the feedback. I got it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, but no. Thanks again, really for the opportunity to share. What my experience has been in the community and as a community theater player and how it sort of mushroomed. I was fortunate enough to work with the late Robert Wynn Jackson in 83. My first production was A Misbehavin'. Uh-huh. And I had been dancing over at ODU and someone in the name of DeShera Rainey suggested that I come over and dance at Norfolk State. And as a result, I ended up staying, working in the theater at Norfolk State for 27 years.
Mm-hmm.
So,
wow, along with your duties as a social worker in Virginia
yeah,
Beach?
Yeah, every evening, my evenings were spent at NSU in the theater. And then following Robert's death, and the sheriff took over the summer arts program that Leah just mentioned that used to be a dance program with Danny Scarborough would come mm-hmm. from California every year. The sheriff took over the program and then I ended up being director mm-hmm. of the summer arts program
mm-hmm.
until we folded in 2002. And that was in conjunction with the Southeastern Virginia Arts Association.
Right.
And the university, SEVA and the university. So that was my inroad to working in the theater and performing in the theater.
Well, was it a degree program then, BA in, let's see, drama and theater at that time?
Or no, it was a, no, that's more recent. That okay. it, well, at that time, it was an English degree, you know, because the old thinking was, if you can't make it as an actor, you can always teach. so they pushed very hard for an English theater degree that seemed to work for most of the people. So when Jill and Yvonne Duché, Denise Dow, mm-hmm. and those folk graduated from the program, it was a English degree.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was, and if people can remember back in the 80s and maybe a little earlier than that in the 70s, when after Wynn Jackson came there, those plays, they were big productions. And for this area, mm-hmm. that was the thing to go to. We didn't have the big, you know, plays coming through, national plays coming through as often. But the big deal was going to one of the Robert Wynn Jackson productions that they might have at Willard Hall or in Brown Hall.
Mm-hmm.
So talk about how significant that was to the area and you know.
Okay. Robert was a IC Norcom
yes,
Greyhound.
Thank you.
Student
an
prodigy.
Amazing Greyhound.
Yes, he was a Greyhound. And he left Norcom and went to Adelphi. Mm-hmm. University in New York, where he had the opportunity to hobnob and rub shoulders with folk on Broadway.
Mm-hmm.
So he got to be in the midst of a revival of Broadway in the late 60s and early 70s of Hello Dolly. And he was friends with Josephine Premise, He had met Maureen Stapleton and Lily Tomlin. He was friends with William Warfield, who sang in Showboat, Old Man River. He had contacts with Gordon Parks. So he had all of those connections. And so when he came and started working at the university, is my understanding, he brought a lot of that with him. And musical theater was his thing. However, in the early days, they also did full-fledged dramas, you know, productions too. It wasn't just music, musical theater. They witnessed to the prostitution. I think Jill did a production of Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf?
Yes, yes.
And you're talking about Jill Holly.
Jill Holly, yes.
Yeah, I'm sorry, Jill Holly Jenkins, yeah. So it was a well-rounded kind of program at that time. But as you said, it wasn't a theater degree program. It was just English drama, and he played to the community. People were excited about a Wynn Jackson production.
That's for sure.
You know, it was a big deal. He would pack out Brown Hall, and then in the later years, we went to Chrysler to perform. And Virginia Wells Theater. To perform. I think we covered most of the theaters at the time. The attics had not been renovated at that time, but we covered most of the theaters to perform it.
You know, they were great performances. I used to go to those performances, and I was single then, and I went there looking for the ladies and end up enjoying the program and going home alone. But but that was how significant or how good those performances were. It took my attention away from what I originally went there for.
Right. Yeah. You know, we did an all black cast of Sound of Music from the children and the whole bit. He could always put a twist on. He always had a twist on something. We did Oliver with Marcus Bell, Carolyn Bell, the late Carolyn Bell.
Played
Oliver. And Robert said it in Old Norfolk as opposed to it being in London. He said it in Norfolk and made reference to the Capistella Bridge, and he had someone to dramaturge and to research all of that, include that in. So he could put a twist on some things and make it his own.
Put a twist on Shakespeare.
Yeah, they did several Shakespeare pieces. He and the Sheriff did a piece, The Revenge of Desdemona. And it was a comic piece, but Robert is a straight man, so he's going with the whole bit, and the Sheriff is the comedian that plays Desdemona, and she as the comedian brings it to a current kind of thing. It was a part of her one woman show that was a really big hit.
And I had always, I told you, Vince, earlier, I had to go back and do my little research because I thought that you had performed also when Danny Scarborough came into town, but you said that you did not perform when he came. Aisha had an opportunity to dance, to be in his production of When Roosters Crow, Something's Supposed to Happen. Mm-hmm. And I don't know why, in my mind's eye, I could see you there dancing, but that was quite a production. But Robert Wynn Jackson, his talent was just so amazing. You know, as a young student, he won the Ted Mack Amateur Hour. Playing the accordion, you know. And he he also had some major productions, play productions at IC Norcom when he was a student there.
When he was a student, yeah.
Yeah, and Mr. Savage also performed in some of his productions. And I know one was on Count Dracula, as well as a few others, but Robert was a force to deal with in this area when it came to plays. And I tell you what, I tried my best not to miss anything that he brought to the stage because it was going to be well done.
Yes.
You know, Robert was second to none, and he wouldn't have any second raters in there at any time.
Yeah.
And,
God bless you if you took a speech class.
Oh, honey.
Right. I heard stories. We laugh about a story that that Robert was holding auditions for a musical production. And true professor that he was, he would always say to the students, if you're coming to audition, you should have a musical theater number prepared. But if not, you need to sing gospel or something of that nature. He was not big on pop music for auditions. And a young lady came up and she did a rendition of Donna Ross's Do You Know Where You're Going?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, Robert was also known to be very cutthroat.
Very much so.
And so the young lady started to sing, Do You Know Where You're Going? And Robert stopped her in the middle and said, Do You Know Where You're Going? Please leave. So he was a perfectionist in a lot of regards. And you were not going to hit that stage unless you had all things together.
Exactly.
I as a college graduate and a resident of Virginia, I was saying "git," G-I-T, as Black folks pronounce "git."
Uh-huh.
And he would, I'd learned the correct pronunciation was "get." And it was, as a speech professor and a theater director, he spent a lot of time on pronunciation and diction.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so he was truly a well-rounded instructor, theater director for that reason.
And say a little bit about Cal Parker and Jill Holly, because they were amazing.
I think, if I'm correct, Jill had made a name for herself in high school prior to coming.
That's right.
Norfolk State.
Where was she in high school?
Where she go? Where did she go?
Israel Charles Norcom.
Thank you. Israel Charles Norcom High School.
High school.
Historically black high school.
In Portsmouth, Virginia. And had appeared at the old Tidewater Dinner Theater.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, yeah.
Production of Pearlie. And I think she'd done some other things there too. So she was ready to go when she enrolled at Norfolk State. And I believe it was shortly around the time that Robert came. So that would have been 74 or 75, that school year. And Jill used to tell the story that she started out as a music major and she had gone over to Dr. Georgia Ryder to sing. And, you know, Dr. Ryder was in charge of the set tech.
Mm-hmm.
And they were aerial wide known and renowned for this women's set tech that sang. And she said, Jill said she sang for Dr. Ryder. And Dr. Ryder said, oh, yes, we have to get you over to the theater because you're not going to fit in here. So she got to star and do a number of productions there on that stage. And Kyle and Jill were a part of the NSU performers.
Uh-huh.
So Robert had two tiers. Let me back up a minute. Stanley G. Wilson, I believe, was the first considered theater director at the Norfolk Division of Virginia State College, Norfolk State. And I believe Tim Reed was one of his students.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And so Robert had the Stanley G. Wilson repertory. He had the NSU players, and then he had the NSU performers.
Mm-hmm.
So the mere fact that you were a student at NSU and did a production, you could be a player. To be in the Stanley G. Wilson repertory, you had to have so many hours of stage experience and have working on the stage. And then to be a performer, you had to have a specialty act. You needed to be able to sing. You needed to be a triple threat. You needed to sing, dance, and act.
Mm-hmm.
And Kyle Parker and Jill, Holly, were both original members of that troop.
Mm-hmm.
So Portsmouth stood the test.
Yes, indeed.
I understand that Robert may have saying he in high school, he and Peggy Britt may have
he
had
and Peggy a, Britt. That's right. I have a picture of he and Peggy Britt together at Norcom High School.
Yeah.
Yes.
They may have had a group or something that sang as well. So it was far reaching in terms of the people that had contact and had influence with him.
Yes, and Norcom put some amazing talents out here into the world, I must say.
And so did Crestwood. So did Crestwood.
And so did. Tim Reed came out of Crestwood.
Yeah.
Crestwood had Vincent.
Yeah. Drop those names.
Yeah.
Carolyn, you want to get in there?
Yeah. Vincent, well, first I'll talk to people out there in Electron Lands. The views stated on this program are the guests and the hosts, so we have to do that disclaimer and not of the radio show. So it keeps us out of Facebook jail. And the other thing, too, is for those listeners out there, if you enjoy the diversity of programming that we have here at Portsmouth Coffee Talks, we also need your help. And you can send an honorarium or a donation to Portsmouth Coffee Talk, P.O. Box 7664, Portsmouth, Virginia 23707. So had to do some of that housekeeping kind of stuff.
Okay.
So, Vincent, so, you know, with your long history in the arts, do you see where the difference of arts taught, well, I hate to say back in the day, versus back in today's time in the K through 12 schools, and them shorting us out in this thing, it tied to our council, you know, how they're trying to cancel our histories and everything. You see the I think there's a direct correlation on students' performance in other areas. What's your opinion on arts offered to our high school kids now?
Well, it kind of boils down to funding too. As an educator, I have to say that, you know, physical education and the arts are usually the least funded programs.
Yes.
And those programs usually get cut. And I think we got to look at it from across the board too. Parents were more concerned about housing, food, shelter, you know, and clothing, as opposed to, and working for them, as opposed to trying to get their students involved with band or dance or singing or piano lessons. I think there was a time when we as a community pushed those things and really supported students to be involved. So that was one piece that we were dealing with. And then the other piece is that funding was cut for a lot of those kind of programs. You know, all of the research suggests that a well-rounded student benefits from arts programs and music programs and athletic programs. They must make the best kind of student. And when you take one of those away, then the student suffers. And I think the community suffers as well. You know, we as a community fight all the time for community centers, and the kids have to have something to do and those kind of things. But those programs don't always get funding that needs to sustain them. There is some funding, but there's not enough funding. They're not fully funded. I remember hearing when I was in school that the Head Start program was tried, tested, and true. All of the research showed that program benefited a early childhood education program, benefited students, but the federal government never fully funded
it. That's right.
Head Start. I mean, they gave it some money, but for all that it could do or could have done, the programs were never fully funded. So I think we're balancing two things here, what, you know, the parents' support and community support and then funding for those programs. But yes, I was telling James earlier, I started dancing as a part of some self-therapy. I was working as a pediatric social worker, and there was terminal illness or death, and you know, all the time, even when there was an abuse case, it was usually the worst of the worst because it required hospitalization. Mm-hmm. And so I needed something else to do. I needed something that was completely different from your work, you know, because I think we do bring work home with us if we don't cut it off. And I was glad to go back to something that I had done as a child. My parents said I was tap dancing when I was 3 years old. I took a class just to have something to do. And I was glad that I had that arts. I marched in the Crestwood High School marching bombers band.
Poor child. Yeah. But anyway.
And I think I danced with the Martin Dance Group, but that was, you know, my, and I played piano. Actually, I played piano when Robert Wynn Jackson had the same, we had the same piano teacher. And at recital, you know, he was playing Mozart, and we were playing This Is Up.
Chopsticks.
Bam, you know. I even chopsticks. I don't know if I even made chopsticks. I might have been going, dun, 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 dun. That's what I was playing. And I remember that from there, but I was glad that I had that to go back to. And it just sort of mushroomed into something bigger. So I encourage parents all the time, if you see some talent in your child, if your child is truly interested in the arts, you should really kind of hoard that and push that. Now, I know that means that you got to get off from work, and then you got to go pick them up and take them to a program, and then you got to fix dinner and all that stuff, and go back and pick them up, and then go on Saturdays and Sundays, but it's really worth the investment. It's worth
it, yes.
Well, you know what? Before you go, Vincent, you know, it's interesting you say getting the parent involvement. And when I listen to the politicians and say, we fully funded education. And then, as you say, the cuts are work first. And you're underfunding the arts versus the politicians.
Exactly.
Funded everything. And so they're talking out of their, both sides of their mouth.
Right.
You put more funds in a turf field than you are in the arts.
Yeah. Right. Exactly. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Exactly. You know, if I know that we have to have some buy-in, the parents got to sell candy and parents got to, you know, sell dinners as we used to do back in the day. But at the same time, I think it's important to note that some of that money could go towards those programs to cover that. You know, in the old days, you know, students had to work to buy their uniforms for those kind of things. Yes, they gave us some funding, but they didn't give us enough funding.
Exactly.
They didn't fund it fully. So you didn't give us all that you could give us to make the program as solid as it could be.
We want to make that transition from radio to Facebook only. So thanks all the listeners on WGPL 1350 AM. We appreciate you. We're talking with Vincent Epps and a junk professor at Norfolk State University, a graduate of Howard University and the Norfolk State.
And Norfolk, and behold the green and gold.
Yeah, and we're talking about just a little bit of the history of the arts program at Norfolk State, and specifically Robert Wynn Jackson and his contributions. And I piggyback on what you were saying about the underfunding of the arts in the grades 1 to 12. I mean, you know, I'm glad my daughter has, our granddaughter who is four and tap and tumbling and all that kind of classes. So later on, she can decide. And if you don't understand the significance of being involved with something like that, take the halftime at the Super Bowl yesterday. All those dancers in sync like that, they had, you know, they didn't just start that yesterday. Right. You know, those dancers came from, probably started at four, you know, and so the opportunities are out there, you know, and we have to support, even though the funding might be low, but when we have these arts in our high school, we have to support them like we go to the football and basketball games. And I guess when you crowd those theaters and things like that, maybe the people that make those policies and do that funding will see the need to fund these those arts and the bands and the choirs more. So just wanted to throw that in. Yeah,
fund them fully.
You know, and plus we don't need a turf field right now. Yeah. Not in high school. In my opinion.
And plus, the parents need to encourage their children to participate in the arts. The young people today just don't seem to want to participate in the arts. I know
not everybody's going to be a basketball star like me.
Has been fighting to get students to join the band. You know, because one time you had feeder programs that fed good band students into the high school. Those, even though they may have the little band programs in the middle schools, it's not a good feeder now. He actually had to take kids who had never been in band before and bring them into the band to bring them up to the level in which they need to be. So the youth don't want to participate in the arts. You know, I think about the little theater group we have at Norcom. Very few kids participate in that program, you know. And I guess too, we don't have the caliber of individuals who really work with our kids with the drama program. Now we do with the band and program, but not the drama program, you know, which could do so much for our youth if we could get them involved, get them ready to participate. They just don't seem to want to do that anymore. I don't know if they can't see what the possibilities are. The
possibilities are. Yeah, uh-huh. What could actually happen? We used to say, or I used to say during the summer arts program, we are not trying to create future actors, musicians. We're just trying to create patrons of the arts, people who can appreciate it and come and see it. And out of that group, we may have five or six that will choose it as a profession. So I don't know if we really, as a community, see the value in that, or we are just distracted by all of the other things that by all the other things that are kind of going on. You know, I defer from saying this, but it's sort of true. There was a time when you were told you are going to do this.
Thank you.
And you did it. And I don't know what happened with that along the way, but I hear parents say, oh, but they don't want to do it. And I'm like, make them do it. What happened to that? You know, they don't want to do that. We offered, let me do a quick switch. The Chesapeake Virginia Beach Alumni Chapter, Kappa Alpha Psi, Fraternity Incorporated, the greatest fraternity in the world, offers a Botillion scholarship program. And it's much like a Eureka's debutante kind of presentation.
Right.
And so the kids make money from selling ads and they're given scholarships. And there's so many of the kids we think who could benefit from just the year-long program of workshops and contact with college-educated men and that kind of thing, enrichment programs. We hear all the time from parents, oh, well, he don't want to do it. And I think at that point, a parent should step up and say, no, you are going to do this because of the benefits of that, the contacts that you will make. You know, we had someone to come in and talk about a FAFSA and how to fill out a FAFSA and scholarship, what money's out there for college and those kind of things. And some students would not hear that from their school counselors, mm-hmm. or not be exposed to that, or some families may not know of that. And I think those are the times when parents need to say, oh no, you are going to do this. Mm-hmm. You are going to be involved in this. On the other hand, if they are showing an interest, then parents, you push them and you support them in that interest, whatever that means there. If you got it, you know, get them there. You try to get them there. If, you know, grandma got to drive the car and somebody pick them up in the evening or whatever. You do what you need to do to keep them engaged. I think it's a better word in those kind of activities.
So you're right. Sometimes parents are so quick, as soon as the kids say, no, I don't want to do that anymore. And you're right. And I remember in generations, you know, you didn't have a choice. My dad used to, I think, for the sake of it, they asked me, did I want to do something? And I said, well, you asking me? No. He said, well, you're going anyway.
Right, you're going anyway.
Yeah. But he would just ask me, being polite, his weight at me and say, well, you're going anyway. I said, mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
But I did it, you know, and because I had to, because he was the parent.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I think exactly. We might be missing the ball on that. And then one other thing, another reason we need to support the arts in the high school level, because you hear about all these actresses and that have made it, and singers that made it, that said one of the things that really got them motivated early on when they performed and looked out there and heard that laughter or heard those claps and heard mm-hmm. those, that saw that audience out there, they were sold, you know, mm-hmm. and staying and being dedicated to that. So if the kids now are doing a performance and it's just your parents and three other people sitting in the audience, what kind of motivation is
yeah, right. That's gym? True. That's very right. true.
Let me go try out for the basketball team because the gym is packed.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know, so, you know, so we have a certain responsibility. I'm good for throwing that responsibility back on us. You know, we can talk about and go for what we need, what the politician need to do as far as policy and things like that. But we have a certain responsibility too, in order to encourage our youngsters to do things. Everybody's not going to play football, basketball, or do some right. of the things, but we might miss out on some talents if we don't give them the opportunity to express themselves that mm-hmm. way.
Right. Well-rounded students. We got to go back and push that too. Well-rounded students who do well in math, do well as musicians, they say. That's what the research suggests. Or vice versa, students who are great in music or whatever do well in math. So I am a social worker because I did not do well in math, although I could tap dance. I am the exception to the rule. I thank my parents for seeing that and supporting that and pushing something that I just kind of enjoyed doing as a child. It, like I said, it mushroomed into something that I had never ever imagined it would do. And becoming artist in residence for the NSU Players, mm-hmm. I got to conceive and write and direct a show that we performed in the Edinburgh Theater Festival. I got mm-hmm. to go to Europe with the NSU Players three times in doing a production. So I think it opened all kinds of doors. I performing in the community, someone saw me dance and who was an agent and called me and said, they're having auditions for dancers in Wilmington, North Carolina. They're making a movie of the 30s and the Audubon Ballroom and the Savoy. And I just mm-hmm. think you would be a great person to go. And I went, didn't know anything. A group of us went from here, didn't know. And I ended up being in a movie directed by Debbie Allen.
Okay.
Oh, wow.
It just mushroomed. I never ever envisioned that. Now I got to put I do believe in divine intervention. I do believe that God controls that and directs that too. So it was a journey that was divinely ordained. I believe you know
you had talents if Debbie Allen cast you in anything. I'm telling you, that's amazing.
So think how good you would a trial lawyer or a marketing exec or even an army colonel would be if they had some drama training.
Right. Can you imagine a trial lawyer with drama training who could do that closing argument and add that spice?
Yeah, I believe OJ's attorney has some some drama training.
Yes, he was a good Kappa man. So,
but Vince, I'm trying to remember if we talked about it prior to your coming on, or I don't get much sleep on Sunday nights because I'm always afraid I'm going to oversleep. So, but did we mention Norma Raglan and Katie Davis during this segment or before we came
on,
and the role that they played?
No, we didn't. Dr. Katie Davis and Norma Raglan, who were professors of English and speech and drama at NSU prior to Robert's coming, were very instrumental in keeping the theater program going. Early on, the university offered a English degree with a concentration in theater, but it was the thinking that if you don't become active, if you don't become famous, at least you can go teach. And so they operated from that standpoint. And prior to Robert Wynn Jackson's arrival at the university, I believe Katie had directed The Wiz and had done some other, it was a joint effort between the three of them, as well as appearing on stage. I think he got it. He just sort of pulled it together and it just kind of floated off far from what the original idea was, because he was truly a genius. In fact, that he was a conductor. He played piano, and then he had the speech piece and drama piece in there as well. I think we have to find Norma, and you all have to have her on to talk about those early days. And I understand she was a, Leah, you said that she taught at S.H. Clark.
She was my teacher at S.H. Clark, and I was on a play. I had to be a blind girl. I was trying to remember the name of the play. I could not remember it. But yeah, but Norma Raglan.
Helen Keller?
No, that wasn't anybody. Helen Keller. Norma Raglan was instrumental in putting on excellent plays at S.H. Clark. Junior high school then. And I had Dr. Katie Davis as my speech teacher. And she did, you thought Robert Wynn Jackson didn't play. Katie Davis did not play either. So
Right. So I think from there they collaborated, and that program became a strong program for the community. I think Dr. McDermott used to say we were a community. That was a word that she used, because, you know, Norfolk State was truly vested in the community.
Exactly.
And as you said, James, early on, in those early days of theater, people came. Those productions were the productions that people saw when we didn't have traveling Broadway coming to Chrysler. I'm thinking of the productions that Robert Wynn Jackson did. We did The Sound of Music. We did Hello, Dolly. We did Sweet Charity. We did Bubbling Brown Sugar. Ain't Misbehaving. Mm-hmm. He did a number of musical reviews. Those were all shows that were had been hits on Broadway that he got to do.
Yeah. Colonel, you know, even the arts, as far as music, you know, can carry on to the military. People go in the military because the Army, the Air Force, I think the Navy, all of them have world-renowned bands.
Yes.
And which they develop singers and everything. So even in the military, you know, a background in the arts can be an advantage to you.
Yes. You know, you mentioned a band because, you know, that's a career field, is to play in the band. So you could do your 20 years, get a retirement, right, all that other stuff by being a member of one of the bands across this nation. And each service has its own bands and or several bands that they do all the ceremonies and everything else that you know that we do across this world. But I think that we need an educational process to educate both the students and the parents about the benefits of an education or in arts, because and how it helps citizens or future citizens to be better citizens.
Mm-hmm.
So we've got to get back to, you know, to the drawing board, and so explain to the students, if you do this, you know, not forcing them to do this, but if you have exposure to this, you know, you're going to be a better, you know, you could be a better mathematician, or you're going to be a better student. And also, it's going to keep you, it's going to keep the kids busy. So they're not out there, you know, doing whatever's happening out there.
Hours and hours of rehearsal or practice time. You know, kids are dancing or preparing for a performance keeps you off the street.
Mm-hmm.
And you still can have some fun too, because I think the contacts and the group of people that you meet who are like-minded in the theater can be lifelong friends as well. I know in the other segment, I got to work at an issue through the Cher Rainey, mm-hmm, who was working at the university at the time. And I don't think when Cheryl was a student there, she worked in the theater. She was a music education major, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
But she came to work with Robert, and she suggested that I come over and audition. And so that connection was the connection that brought me there. And she brought a lot of us. I think I sent some pictures of the I posted a picture on Facebook of the Wynn Jackson performers.
Mm-hmm.
Sarah actually put us, that group of people together. She brought all of us to the theater to end up working with Robert. And following his death, we saw it fit to name ourselves the Wynn Jackson performers, because mm-hmm, we still saw ourselves as great performers, and we thought we could still do that. And we did, you know, traveled around the city as well as North Carolina to perform under the name the Wynn Jackson Performers.
And Deshaun Rainey was quite a performer.
She lit the
stage up when she made her entrance. From the time of her entrance to her exit, you knew that Deshaun was on the stage.
Yes, she was dubbed the Earth Mother of the Blues.
Yes, she was.
I think she enjoyed musical comedy, mm-hmm, and theater as much as she enjoyed teaching, because she, mm-hmm, was also a arts teacher. Deshara, Vanessa, Jill, Renee Williams Walk.
Yes.
Juan Garrido, Joyce Dunbar, Don Lindsay, myself, Wilbur Parker were a part
Wilbur
of
Wilbur Parker, group. Yes.
Yeah, who were part of the group that we began singing and performing and keeping that piece alive for us and the community as well, because mm-hmm, I think people enjoyed hearing show tunes and seeing the talents that we had, that he had sort of put together.
Yeah. Vincent, I see that the present arts or drama and theater department, they have a relationship with the Virginia Stage Company. Was that something that, do y'all have one back in the day, or that,
yes,
you know, that was?
Yes, we did. You know, Robert was about exposure, being a bigger than life person himself. Yeah. So we did The King and I at the Wells Theater. And he made that connection because the Wells Theater was dark in the summer.
Mm-hmm.
And as a part of the university's reputation and involvement, as well as the Southeast Virginia Arts Association, we went in and performed an all black version of The King and I at the Wells Theater.
Hmm.
So
most of the audience was white.
Huh?
Most of the audience was white, right?
yeah, we had, well, he played to a
mixed audience.
It was a mixed audience. Mm-hmm. He really played to a mixed audience, and people, because of his reputation, people would come and to his shows. We did Porgy and Bess, and the Gershwin family does not license that production to a non-professional group. Mm. It never licensed Porgy and Bess to a student organization. But because of Robert's contacts and who he was and his where to with and know how, the Gershwin family agreed to give that production to NSU, and we did it. Now, he brought in some professional performers, but it was mixed with community players and students for a large, big production of Porgy and Bess that played at Chrysler Hall. Now, Chrysler Hall seats like maybe 2,700, 2,300.
Mm-hmm.
And to see that packed is amazing. And we did it several times.
You know? Yeah, and to take on something like that with the statue of the original players of that play, you know, was it like Sidney Poitier? And
Sidney Poitier did the movie.
He did the movie, okay.
Yeah.
Dr. Dandridge.
Those folks,
Sammy Davis.
So, I got to play Sport Life, and that was a Sammy Davis.
Oh, okay.
So,
see where that tap came into handy?
That tap came in handy.
Made you well-rounded.
Yes.
So, Vince, do you get an opportunity to do any dancing now, or have you put your tap shoes up?
I have not hung my tap shoes up completely. I've done more plays than musical theater recently. I've done several things down at the Zeiler's American Dream Theater in Town Center in Virginia Beach. Clyde Santana, who is a professor, also a professor at Norfolk State, saw me perform years and years ago, and he remembered me. He had my phone number, and he was teaching playwriting at the Addicts Theater. He had a group that he was teaching, and out of that group, some of those productions get to be performed as new plays, or we'll do an excerpt from those. So I've did several of those at the Z Theater, but I hadn't gotten a chance to tap dance in a minute. He wrote a show that Dr. Clarence Murray, who was the theater director following Robert's death at Norfolk State, did called Bo. And it was based on the life of Bilbo Jangles Robinson. And I got to play the role, or I got to dance the role of Bilbo Jangles Robinson.
Wow.
Yeah. So hadn't had a chance to do much of that. But now that I am an adjunct professor in the Evelyn R. Strong School of Social Work, I say that all together. Most of my time is teaching students on how to deliver service to the community and to the clients, and helping them be the best social workers they can be. But I enjoy just as much. My degrees are not in both my undergraduate and graduate degrees in social work, and then I got a second master's in gifted education. I didn't major in theater or dance or anything. I truly believe it was all divinely inspired, as I said, God-given talent that I just kind of honed. Now, I had to do some training. You had to hone your talent, but that's kind of how it developed.
And Vincent, we can't go off there without mentioning your greatest supporter of all, Ann Brown.
Yeah.
Ann Brown was your supporter. Live, I mean, she was your ride or die.
Yeah, she was my ride. Always
there in support of you in everything that you did.
Ann and I worked at as pediatric social workers.
Right, at Children's Hospital. So,
but prior to that, Ann had also attended the great school across the water, Crestwood High School, before attending Ice North.
Before attending where? She came.
I see Northern High School.
Okay, thank you.
She saw the light.
Okay, she saw the light. She came home.
And so we had been high school friends. And then the work together was just great. And so when I started dancing, she knew what I was doing in the afternoons and that thing. So she always came to support the productions that we were doing. Whenever we were in town doing something, I could count on her being there. And at times she became a dramaturg. She would come and critique what I had choreographed or what students had done, and she put her 2 cents in too. So it's been 5 years since she left us, and posted that on Facebook last week.
Yeah,
it doesn't seem like it's been that long. Yeah,
it doesn't seem like it's been that long.
No.
Yeah, no. Good person. Excellent person.
Yeah,
also a long time Grove Baptist member.
Right. We, you know, that neighborhood was out there. That, you know, those little black pockets. There was Twin Pine. There's Twin Churchland. Pines. There's Belleville. There's Pewsville. Yeah. There was Huntersville. And my mom and I never got to go to the place. They said it was something called Sugar Hill. Were neighborhoods out there in that area. And then when Norfolk County became part of Portsmouth, we lost a lot of that. The old church and high school, you remember, was a Chesapeake.
It was. School. That's right. That's right.
Yeah. I think my dad taught there.
Your dad taught my parents in high school. That's our connection.
Okay.
And they would have reunions, and he would, you know, always be there. And the school is located behind the McDonald's in Churchland. I don't know if it's American Legion building or what. I think that building is still there.
The building is still there. Mm-hmm. So I recall.
Back there that. And that was 1937, 38, somewhere around in there before he left to go to law school, I believe.
He left there and went to, Oakwood. It was a school in Norfolk where he was promoted to principal. And then that's where he got fired. But out in Churchland, that's where he met my mother, teaching out in Churchland. He met my mother out there because she lived in what they call now Ebony Heights.
Ebony Heights. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. It wasn't called that all the time. It was just the country when I used to go out there and stay. But anyway, we're winding down. So I guess we can do our wrap ups. And Colonel, you want to start?
Yeah. Vincent, thank you for coming on and adding to the diversity of our program. And I'd like to thank you again and tell you to keep on doing what you're doing and spreading about the needs of the arts and theater and that whole genre to make our society better. Thank you.
Thank you for the invite, Crestwood Bomber.
Well, although you were a Crestwood Bomber, I have always been a fan of yours. I followed you as you performed in many productions, and it's always been a joy. And it was always a joy to my heart when I see you and Ann together. You know, always a good time when being in the both of your presence. But I want to thank you also for coming on. And I want to encourage you to please try to get in touch with Norma Ragland and Katie Davis. We would love to have them on during Women in History Month to talk about some of the things that they have done as well. But once again, I want to thank you. And don't put those tap shoes up, okay?
I won't.
Keep on dancing.
I won't.
I tell you so. I just want to say thank you. Thank you so very much for coming on Portsmouth Coffee Talk.
You're welcome. Thank you for having me.
And I'd just like to say one of the goals of one of the things we like to do here on Portsmouth Coffee Talk is share history, especially during Black History Month, and show that the world is bigger than a lot of us perceive. And it's a lot we can serve. And as we honor national heroes, I think our youth, our students need to know about the local people that made significant strides here, you know, Robert Wynn Jackson, Vincent Epps. You know, we need to know about people that right here that you can touch and feel and learn from. And that's one of the goals we have here on Portsmouth Coffee Talk is educating people about the local people as well as the national. They're going to get their props, the national heroes and national people that made history. But we make history right here locally. And we need to make sure if they take it out of our schools, we'll take the responsibility of making sure that that history is passed down to our students. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So thanks again. We appreciate you coming on. And, you know, and I'm glad you found out you don't have to be a Greyhound to be on this.
But there's one of the first things you said. I was beginning to believe.
But James, but you have to rub shoulders with a few Greyhounds. Yeah. Okay.
I was beginning to believe
We're trying to diversify, Vincent. We're trying to diversify. We're trying to bring people on from Western Branch and Crestwood. And so if you know someone out there from Crestwood who has done some amazing things, tell them to get in touch with us because we would love to have them on.
Tell Tim Reed to give us a call.
Okay.
We appreciate you. And Portsmouth Coffee Talk is here for our voice,
our community,
and our future.
We salute you, Vince.
And we salute you.
Thank you for all that you've done and all that you will continue to do
for
the community.
Thank you, Vince.
Keep following the Norfolk State Drama and Theater Department. They're still going. They're still making history. You know, down the road, we'll be talking about them too. Hopefully we can get the two ladies that you mentioned on to talk about some more history of Norfolk State's drama program. So. Thanks again, and take care, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you all for watching.
Oh, and join us Thursday as we have our guest host, reoccurring guest host, Dr. Ernestine Duncan, a professor at Norfolk State, who'll be coming here and talking about gratitude. We talk about all the, in mental health, we talk about all the downsides and things that happen. She's going to come and talk about gratitude going forward in this 2023 year. Sometime we don't celebrate that as much, some of the things we are grateful for. Exactly. So join us Thursday at 7:00. All right. Take care, everybody.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thanks again.
All right. Bye-bye.